Here is a little bit of summary regarding memory. It is a vibration that is zero dimensional. There is only change there. The change is change of possibilities, potentials, not of anything else. Structures reside in this memory as patterns of vibrations. There are mostly structures that do not last. They're as good as not there. Some structures, they self-organize or are stable via copying or some other processes. Because it is a vibration, the structures produce a signature vibration that propagates in the memory through resonance or copying. There are special structures that can respond to these disturbances and can format and limit the incoming disturbance and can arrange them in specific order. These arrangements, they shine as experiences. The rest forms a background which is mostly random and unseen. So this was a summary. It is beautiful. There are no objects. There is no matter. There are no bodies. And there are no problematic things called minds. It is all non-physical, non-mental. It is devoid of substance. It is essentially emptiness that is witnessing itself. It is me witnessing myself. That's all it is. Now let us continue the study of our model of the memory. Another interesting question is, how many kinds of experiences are possible here? Although, logically speaking, there is no limit. The experiences are infinite. Their kinds are also infinite. However, we need to concentrate on those that are within our experience, where our intellect goes. The rest are logically inferred, but some of them are directly experienced. There is a perception of it. Although it is completely faked, as we saw in the last episode, still it can be inferred that there is something. Even though the perception is mostly geared towards survival, we can even postulate that there is no limit to perception also. It can be altered to perceive same things in a different way or new things. The range of the perception can be broadened to perceive that which cannot be perceived ordinarily. There are no hard limits here. There is no such necessity here that the experience will be limited to this and only to this. And as we'll see, this model that is proposed here does a very good job of explaining it. Let us try to study the kinds of experiences that we are already having that will be more meaningful. Everybody is familiar with the five senses. They give us an experience of the objects, which we call as the world, which is a collection of all that which these five senses are telling us. In the last episode, I gave you some hint that the senses extend into the local memory, of which we are ultimately having the experience. We do not actually experience objects or these vibrations that reside in the NP and M memory. We do not actually experience what the senses are producing. And we do not actually experience the local memory also. We experience something called the irreducibles that do not seem to reside in the local memory also. Local memory is also vibration. The irreducibles do not have any existence, you can say. They are completely empty, devoid of any objective reality. Yet, that is what is possible to experience. So every experience comes in the form of irreducibles. There is no limit to what these irreducibles can be. It is an open-ended arrangement. It appears whenever there is a need to perceive. If there is a need to perceive something new, a new irreducible appears, provides an experience of that. So these five senses, they extend into the local memory. The eyes do not see, the ears do not hear, the tongue does not taste, hands do not touch, and the nose does not smell. They are transducers. They convert the incoming vibration into a formatted vibration. That's all they do. Something which can travel down the nervous system as signals. The real seeing happens in the local memory. The real smelling happens in the local memory. That is the place of senses. The organs of senses are extensions of the nervous system. And finally, they are visible as an object. The senses sense themselves as organs. So it is very important to understand that the senses extend into the local memory, and there is no clear boundary really. These five senses come under a form of perception that is called exterioception, which means they give us information about what is external to the body. So I'm giving you the scientific names, or you can say names used by people who study these senses or treat the disorders of these senses, which indicates that each of the senses produces its own perception, and all these are then combined to form an object. So there is a difference between the football that you see in a picture and the football that you play with. Although to the eyes they look perfectly the same, but we know that they are different objects because one lacks the other senses. You cannot touch it, you cannot feel its weight, and so on. So the object is made up of a combination of these five senses. Out of these objects, a very special object is the body. How do we know that I have a body? Because we can move it. And how do we know that it is moving, or it is placed right side up, it is not hanging upside down, or that it has fallen? We know this without the help of the five senses also. There are special sets of senses in the body that provide information about the body, mostly its muscular activities. This is called the proprioception, or it can be called the kinesthetic senses. We know that my hand is moving without using the five senses. I know that the pillow feels very, very light, but the dumbbells are very heavy. This is the information being conveyed by the joints and the muscles. This is not coming from the five senses. In fact, if these senses are absent, we won't be able to walk. We won't be able to grasp things with our hands. And we won't be able to tell whether we are lying down or standing upright. We won't be able to dance or climb a tree. It is amazing that your textbooks or the school books, they do not have this information. When we are told about senses, we are told about these five external senses only. I don't know the reason. This gives us an illusion that it is my body because I can move it around and I know where it is. Without these senses, the body would become a foreign object. Not only that, the body sends many kind of signals. There are transducers inside the body. And probably they are more than those that are outside. This is also very interesting and surprising because that is also not taught to ordinary people. For example, we know when we are feeling cold, and we know when the body temperature is high, it starts sweating. There are sensors in the body to sense the body temperature, which is called thermoception. There are sensors to sense the pain. If something goes wrong in the body, something breaks in the body, there is a damage to the body, which is called nociception. Now, these scientific names are not important. The body also sends the signals of pleasure. Everybody knows that. The body also sends signals about its needs. For example, hunger and thirst. There are sensors, there are transducers to do that. They all extend to the local memory. There is something interesting here that the touch is always of the external object. And then the touch is then localized externally, that I am touching something which is not me. However, the experience is of me only, not of the object. The experience is of the sensations produced by the skin. The objects produce nothing. Similarly, when I taste something, the taste is now then attributed to the food. Same for smell. However, they are not localized because there is no need to do that. Probably in some animals, the sense gets localized also. It is amazing. They immediately start running in the direction from where the smell is coming, or they are running away. You can sense a cold object and you can sense a hot object, and then that heat or cold is projected on the object. The object is not cold and the object is not hot. There is only a difference of temperature with respect to the body. So these internal senses, they are extremely important. Without it, the body will die. You can include the senses that provide us with information on fullness of bladder, or the need to excrete. These are also senses. Probably some of the literature may mention the interoception, but there are senses that only philosophy books mention. They are not even recognized as senses, and therefore there is no scientific name for them. They are the feelings, emotions, thoughts, imaginations, desires, memory recalls, and dreams. So I'm going to name them as psychoception, because they are perceptions of the states of the mind. Now I'm showing it as a cloud because there is absolutely no localization here. You cannot locate any of these sensations. Feelings are something which are ill-defined. It is a nebulous word. But here I've defined the feelings as sensations that are connected to the body. They are 50% in the body and 50% in the mind. When you are afraid, the body shakes, the heartbeat increases, and the eyes are darting here and there. Although fear comes under emotion, but this fear is felt in the body. It happens when there is a really fearful situation. The emotion of fear is more subtle, and for example, the worry, it is just a fear. It does not show up in body so much. Everybody is familiar with the emotions. There are 9 kinds of emotions. I'm not going to go into the details there. Everybody knows them. But they probably don't know that how are these emotions known without any sense. Nothing to worry. There are internal senses, psychosenses, that convey these irreducibles which are experienced. Somebody may ask, no, where is the organ of the sense that senses emotions? You will find there are people in whom these emotions are attenuated somehow, or you must have found people in whom these emotions are probably more than normal. Some people are more fearful. Some people are more sensitive to anger. Some people are kind of indifferent. They don't have these feelings of love and compassion. For example, criminals and psychopaths and extremely selfish people. Before killing somebody, they won't feel the same emotions or feelings which a healthy person, a mentally healthy person would feel. Or in some people, the emotions of, let us say, disgust are suppressed. In soldiers or butchers, they are not disgusted when they see blood or dead bodies. These malfunctions, they point to the possibility that there are non-physical structures that convey these non-physical experiences. Since these are irreducibles, they cannot be reduced to something else, it is almost guaranteed that a sense is generating them. And there are as many senses there in the mind as there are these experiences. So, you will be surprised now, because to sense the external world, there are only 5 senses. To sense the body, there are probably 10 to 15 senses. To sense the mind, there are probably 50 senses, although I never counted them. How is that even possible? How come I don't know all these things? Without these senses, the psychoception, there is no life. There is only this robot, which is messing around with physical objects. There are senses that can convey thoughts, and they are mostly excitations of the 5 senses, body and emotions. Then there are imaginations. You can imagine or replay any of the sense. I don't know how many people can imagine emotions, but it is possible to imagine visions or sounds. The touch and smell is also very difficult to imagine. Then there are senses that convey the events called desires in the mind. If you are not made aware of the desires, probably you won't do anything. You won't even get up. There won't be any life. The desires pop up in the mind and they are experienced as impulses to do something. Yes, your sense of hunger is telling you to go and eat something, but the desire to watch a movie or to call somebody, that is not coming from these lower senses. So the desires are special processes that convey a need to do something. There is something very interesting here, that the local memory itself can be perceived. We call it recall, or memory recall, or in short, people call it memory. And this local memory is then played back through many of these senses, and it tries to produce the same experience which was original, which when happened was recorded in the local memory. The experiences are coming from the universal memory through the senses, but the recall is coming from the copy of that experience, which is now stored in the local memory. And how is it even perceived? Because the local memory cannot be perceived directly. The local memory uses the extended senses. Like I told you that the senses extend into the local memory. They do not end at the sense organ. It uses the same mechanisms to replay that which is in its own space, local space. Although we don't get this vivid experience in the waking state when the recall happens, we get a faint recall. But some people are very talented. When they recall it, the recall is as good as the original. Visualization of their memories is very vivid, although I doubt that everybody can do it. Mostly our recall is very faint. For example, I ask you to recall the voice of your favorite singer. Probably you will experience something, but there are people who will actually listen to that singer singing in their minds. So my guess here is that the local memory is almost an exact copy of the original experience, the universal memory. The sense of recall is more advanced or less advanced in different people. Similarly, when we can imagine a little bit faint experience, we put together our local memories to produce a new experience, a new perception. That is the difference between imagination and recall, is that recall tries to reproduce the original, but the imagination can modify the original. It can combine elements from the original. Note that imagination is not creation. We cannot create anything. We can only mix and match our recalls. Humans don't create. In some people, the imagination is very vivid. As I said, some people can imagine the smells and tastes also. I've seen that the taste of a lemon is very easy to imagine. And it actually, if you imagine the lemon and its taste and its smell, lemony smell, and imagine a picture of the lemon being cut into half with the juice spilling out, your mouth will actually water. It is so vivid. The mouth and these digestive system and other systems in the body, they cannot tell a difference between whether it is coming from the universal memory or the local memory. They don't see any difference. They react in the same way. Similarly, if you imagine something which produced disgust in the past, a pile of rotting trash, for example, or cow dung, you just need to imagine it and the emotional system will produce disgust. It cannot distinguish whether it is real cow dung or imagined cow dung. The emotion appears nevertheless. Anyhow, there is a special category of imagination, thoughts, emotions, and recalls that mix together. It's an experience, which is dreams. How do we perceive dreams? It is almost a fake copy of the waking experiences. There are people, there are houses, places, events are going on. There is talking, there is hearing, there is seeing, mostly. Sometimes touching, smelling and all that is going on. There are obviously desires and thoughts and emotions in a dream. It is a playback of the daytime experiences. Not exactly. Some random story is there. Even if there is no story, your sleeping intellect cooks up an imaginary story there. How is it all experienced without the five senses? Since the body is paralyzed during the sleep, even the kinesthetic senses are not there. You are not experiencing any pain or pleasure or hunger or anything. The dreams, I have placed them under psychoception, although we may easily make a separate perception category for dreams. They are your everyday or every night experience, and anybody hardly knows what it is. Probably there are more mental senses. There are more ways to have the psychoception, and there are more irreducibles. For example, in different animals, different creatures. So I'm not trying to be exhaustive here. I'm trying to give you only an idea that the number of senses and irreducibles actually increases as you go away from the world or the body. There is more to experience within than there is without. Now that is mind-blowing, and absolutely nothing is mentioned in any of the literature about this. There are experiences which are called the altered state of the mind, in which completely different kind of experiences happen, completely different kind of perception happens. Not only these five senses are absent, not only the bodily and most of the interoception is absent, it is not even like dreams, which are a copy of the waking state. Altered states produce new kind of experiences. And since they are experienced, they must be coming via a sensory system of its own kind. Otherwise, there was no possibility of it. There is some literature about the altered states, such as the states produced via psychoactive drugs or entheogens or messing around with the brain or sensory systems, anesthetics, etc. There is some literature there, but there is a category which is almost thrown under the pseudosciences, where these experimenters have given a very detailed description of these experiences, which are altered experiences, altered states. We are going to study the states of the local memory in detail later on. I call them the states of the local memory because these experiences are just experiences of the local memory. So it is proposed that there are senses beyond the psychosenses, beyond the psychoception, and we enter here the mysterious realm of spiritual experiences. So I'm going to invent one more term here because this is completely absent from the current literature. Nobody studies these things. It will be spiritioception because it rhymes with other receptions. The first one is the altered state of the mind, which is, you can say, is almost an unnatural state of the local memory, brought about by chemicals and hitting your head with hammers and whatnot. It can be argued that it is only a malfunction of the psychoception or other sensory pathways. But this argument is only partially valid, in my opinion, because degradation of the senses usually produces inferior experiences. People have reported extremely vivid and sometimes superior, more real experiences in the altered states. That cannot be explained by degradation of the lower sensory systems. It can be proposed here that because of the drugs or trauma, the lower senses stop functioning correctly and the higher senses responsible for spiritualception become dominant. Although this does not happen very often in the altered state, but there are people of extraordinary abilities where this works perfectly. The disadvantage here is that they get addicted to the drugs and chemicals and other methods. That causes probably permanent damage to the lower systems. They cannot function properly in the world now. It can give you a good trip initially. Later, you become a slave of the drug. But there is a good news that it is possible to train the higher senses. Just like you can train your body or your other abilities through practices. And we enter the mysterious but well-known, at least in the East, realm of meditative states. Now, how many of these states are there? There is no count here. Doesn't look like there is an end here. It almost looks like that these states can be produced on demand. You want this state? Okay, take it. They are not ready-made. They are not pre-manufactured. You get irreducible or you get a new sense on demand here, because here you can see that the physical rules are not that strong. They do not really apply here. In this purple cloud, everything is possible now. Meditative states are the states when the person is completely established in the world, is fully aware of the body, is seeing or hearing or smelling, is aware of the emotions and all. But this is only the beginning. There is a complete spectrum of senses that lies beyond meditative states. If your mind is not already blown, it will completely disintegrate now. Because it is possible to produce states of the local memory that go beyond local memory. So here, it's a free country. And not only the senses can be produced on demand, the bodies and the worlds also appear on demand. Because we are interfacing here with the raw memory, with the raw potential of the existence. There is no limit that is imposed by the lower senses. And I am calling them as projected states for some reasons, for conventional reasons. And we are going to discuss all these states in extreme detail, if you are interested. It seems that there is more as we go up, and it becomes less and less and less as we go down. I am calling these higher states and lower states just arbitrarily because they are drawn usually higher on the paper when we display such diagrams. The physical is bottommost and the grossest, and then it gets finer and finer and finer and bigger, and you see, there is no limit. It is like an inverted pyramid. Just compare this actual experience with what is stuffed into your mind by the society. People have indoctrined you to believe that the most important part of your life is these five senses. Then probably a little bit of emotions and feelings, they play a little bit of role. And don't worry about imagination and thinking and intellect and all. Only 1% of people have them. You are fine without them. Artistic abilities and scientific abilities, you don't need them. Just remain the slave. You're fine. And then there is totally no mention of the biggest part of the spectrum of senses in your society. Even in the educated circles, even in the fringe, this is the fringe of the fringe. This will be never told to you, even in pseudoscience. The pseudoscience goes mostly up to the altered states or something, you see. Some people call the pseudoscience as spirituality. They have no idea what this involves. The ignorance is too deep here in the human society. About what? About what they are themselves. Not about something else. This is you. So when I say higher or lower or superior or inferior, that does not mean that the lower systems are completely useless. We should cut them off and fly off in some other dimension. That is not the intention. They are just words. The five senses are extremely important because they ensure survival. If they don't function properly, as you know, in case of blindness or deafness or whatever, the human life is totally impaired. They are necessary for survival. And now you can guess why your education system and your parents and your leaders and whoever your ideals are, they place most highest importance on the physical part of your life. Because for survival, that's all is needed. You can be a complete dummy, but if you survive, everybody's happy. You don't need to grow more than that. Remain an animal and everybody's happy because they themselves are like that. You try to go higher and you will get complete disapproval. So on the path of knowledge, we are not afraid to explore. And we explore from the bottom. There is a very good rule on the path of knowledge that if you are after truth, if you are after knowledge, it is present right here, right now. You don't need to alter the states of the memory. You don't need to go to meditative states. You don't need to even have the projected states. The truth is universal. It is not dependent on these systems. All you need is a proper criteria for truth. And all you need is proper means of knowledge. Remember, direct experience is the means of knowledge and logic is the means of knowledge. And permanence is the criterion of the truth. With these two simple tools and logical and rational abilities of the intellect, everything can be known. In fact, we are knowing all these sensory systems using these means only. I am not telling you this by reading this book or that book, by referring to this author or that author. No, it is all your own experience. But you can say, no, wait a minute, I don't have that altered experience. Then you are not an explorer. That means you have not explored the full potential of what you are. You are not even a seeker. So this information is meant for seekers and explorers. It is meant to motivate the students to know more, to find out more. Yes, some things can be known only by experiences. And in order to experience, you must experiment. No amount of reading the books, watching the documentaries, movies is going to augment your knowledge. Your experience will provide you this knowledge. This expands your mind, isn't it? There are unlimited possibilities here. And that is why I say that When you know, you will feel yourself small. The knowledge does not make you big. The knowledge makes you humble. I'm so small. I don't know anything. This was only an overview. I left out a lot of things, you see. For example, in case of interoceptions, some of the creatures have senses that sense magnetic fields, like birds, migratory birds. There are creatures in the deep sea that can sense electric fields. There are creatures that sense infrared light, and there is echolocation where the whole vision-like sense is present. Localized objects are seen using just sound. And who knows what else is there? Bees have ultraviolet vision. Snakes have infrared vision. And the spectrum of senses is kind of multidimensional. It extends in this one layer and it extends above the layers which we are familiar with. Is there any truth in this? And no, this is completely false because it is the knowledge of the illusion. Remember, we are dealing with illusion here. Not only this whole memory is an illusion, the senses are illusion, the experiences they produce are complete illusions. There is no truth here.